name is Janet Davis. I'm the president of the Rye Historical Society, and our board is all here, and we are so glad that you joined us. First things first, I'd like for us to acknowledge that this evening we are gathering on tribal land that was originally inhabited by the Penacook and Abenaki tribes. And if you have been aware of what's happening in the world lately, you'll know it's important to know where you live and who are the original inhabitants of the land. So you can take that with you and carry it with you and know that this is where we live and this is where we are learning this evening. So we're very honored to be here and to have guests who are to help us celebrate that. I'd like to say a few things about the Rye Historical Society before I introduce our museum director, Alex Herlihy. We, of course, have our town museum right across the street, right next to the Rye Library. Our mission is to preserve, protect, and promote the history of our town here in New Hampshire. We do that through programming, like tonight. We also offer trolley tours during the summer months, and we enjoy those. Lots of people take us up on those, and you learn about different stops along the way on a trolley tour throughout Rye. We also have exhibitions that happen that we have presenting over in the town museum itself. And those happen to turn over once every couple of years. Right now, we have an exhibition called Fishing, Farming, and Fun. And then finally, we also offer programs throughout the year in conjunction with the, and actually this one, Alex will talk more about this, is celebrating part of our 400th anniversary, which is coming up in 2023. We also have the annual regular programming that happens throughout the year. Tonight, we are streaming this on our Facebook Live account so that anyone who is not able to join us is able to participate, and we will likely continue to do that in the future. Finally, I'll just say, if you are not a member, we would love to have you join us. Debbie is taking memberships out front. We've got various levels of membership, and it's a really wonderful thing for us. That's how we earn the money to promote and protect and preserve the town's history. We are 100% volunteer-led and managed organization. With that, I'll just turn it over to Alice Verlinghi, who is going to introduce our guest speaker. And thank you again for being with us. We're so grateful.
Thanks for coming. Unlike Janet, I'll probably have to read most of this. But we started our 2023 programs in 2017 with geology, then we did the sunken forest, we had flora and fauna. And this program, of course, was supposed to be presented a year ago, but here we are finally. And watch for publicity, because chronologically we are working our way to the present. And for instance, in 2023, you know, one of the programs we'll be doing is a history of what we are in the 20th century, which is a pretty tumultuous and interesting history. So, a celebration of Eastern Woodland Indians. I think it is good for our national mental health to face up to all of our history, the good and the bad. Acknowledging all of our past and working to integrate it into the schools, into public education, is the path to healing and reconciliation. Now, I ask you to imagine the seacoast 500 years ago, 1521, populated by thousands of people of Algonquin speaking soil. Archaeologists tell us that they had been here for up to 10,000 years. Imagine the local Piscataqua people drawn to the lush coastal land and sea, celebrating their rich harvest on South Boss Beach near our ragged neck. Inside of their homes, imagine great seaside festivals with endless piles of shells from the abundance of the sea and great lacrosse games swarming over the sand and sea. It was an artist's tapestry of wood and plant life. Abundance and shelters, both permanent and temporary. Maybe people content who had reached the highest level of a way of life. Then imagine French explorer Champlain appearing off this coast in 1606, following information that comes directly from Parsons' History of Rye. He reported seeing in the area of Rye Harbor dwellings, extensive farming, and perhaps 200 natives around this tidal inlet he called Beauport. Well named, right? On Rye Harbor. Champlain's account of this expedition is a rare early description of what later European settlers would originally call Sandy Beach, where native cultures were well established here. And then the failed contact began to take its toll as European explorers unknowingly exposed natives to diseases which the latter had no immunity to. And up to 90% of the Penacook Confederate tribes perished in some places. Abenaki peoples from the Northeast later began to fill that population void. You've probably seen on PBS some excellent documentaries on Native people this month, one of which is actually about surviving the great die-off. That's on Channel 2 next week. Now, David Thompson, which is what marks this 400th anniversary, he came with a small group and landed at Oregon Point in June of 1623. And probably a settlement may not have been permanent. It can't be proved one way or the other. So that date has been claimed by us. We're the oldest town in the state. The first 50 years are mostly free of major conflicts, but mistrust was building over different views of the land. And I ask you to really think about the land here, because that is really at the heart of this, the issue between the native people and the Europeans coming. Now, natives used it seasonally and shared with others, but the concept of land ownership was alien to them. However, European settlers, many coming from crowded homelands where they could not own land, quickly staked out property and drew up deeds. So these two very different views of the land seem destined to have fatal consequences. But it is worth remembering that in the early years of settlement, many colonists did believe in the idea of the commons, shared land that all were responsible for. But their private property eventually, that concept overwhelmed these efforts. But imagine if native peoples and settlers had been able to communicate clearly about the value of shared land and how it could have led to a peaceful future. We can be grateful for the last 150 years though, right? I mean, look what our federal and state governments have done. Look what our land trusts have done. Look what individuals have done. Look at Parsons Park, Goss Farm, and all the land in this town that has either been donated or easements have been purchased. So we have a lot of public land here. From the 1670s to the 1760s, you could have called that World War I. It was international warfare on three continents. And of course, that superpower rivalry, not between the US and China, but between Britain and France, pitted France's reluctant allies, the Indians, against the British allies, the colonists. Those wars were devastating to all parties, as wars always are, and civilians were often the victims, which included the Brackett family here in Rhine, on Brackett Road, in the 1690s. But of course, also, Indians were burned alive in their dwellings by colonists in this warfare. War always sees atrocities, sadly, on both sides. Now, after the Revolution, many natives were pushed westward by expansion in wars, and U.S. government broke treaties until 1890 when army soldiers massacred 350 women, children, and old men at Wounded Knee, bringing to an end those long wars. And in an effort to eradicate the culture, federal policy mandated that Indian youth attend white run boarding schools well into the 20th century with devastating effects. But some native peoples remained in the East, and their descendants are still here with us. Seasonal Indian gatherings for harvesting of resources and ancient social traditions, both family and tribal, always included music, dancing, and feasting. However, this was not just mere entertainment, as the songs and dances had much deeper meanings that were expressed at that time in a uniquely native way. Today, we are seeing but a shadow of the old culture. We are working with tonight's presenters to have them do programs for our schools over the next 2 years, as well as more public programs like this, and a large celebration outside at Odeon in June of 2023. I first met Ed and Ken 2 years ago, and have attended two of their gatherings. I've learned much from them, as I know you will hear tonight. So I welcome them now to share their great traditions with us. Thank you. We're not focusing on the
17th, 18th, 19th, or even the 1950s centuries, we're modern people. We just happen to be active with some of the living history groups that are around since the bicentennial. That stuff has gotten very popular, perhaps, so you know some of the colonial reenactment groups around here. I do know those guys. I fight them all the time. I want you to appreciate what we have and what we do not have. Modern, don't expect this. I had a museum a specialist in Detroit, a friend of our family's, and he was confronted by local chiefs coming in to check out Ottawa chiefs from Waffle Island. They were coming in to look at the display of the museum at Old Fort Wayne. And they said, well, we weren't warriors, we didn't fight anybody. And he's looking at them going, in this modern regalia, he's like, well, that's not accurate. It's accurate. Everything you are wearing is accurate. You know, it's not, we just happen to choose once in a while a certain target. So if we are, if we're dancing Sioux style, Lakota style dancing, that regalia might be made in that fashion, the women's fashions too. Generally, you don't want to make stuff up, because that's nobody's culture. Although, if you did it, I couldn't say. My Penobscot wife, she decided to put a Clorox bottle on her head and wrap herself in a Mexican blanket. I can't say that's not Penobscot. It was her...
Like in a new tradition.
I didn't come up with that joke, by the way. But what it is if we were being honest anthropologists, we would say that is legitimate modern native expression. That's not what we're doing. We're actually trying to focus on something so that when you come into a dance circle, what you're going to see is a group of people. Indian people don't point. This is how you say up, up, and away in Indian. The pointing is so forgive my modern pointing, but gesturing is that we should be able to see the lineup at the grand entry of the powwow, and that's what our format is here tonight for you. That was a grand entry. So picture all the dancers lined up in the eastern gate, and they're waiting by category. So the men come in first. They have the veterans carry the flags, and we honor the American flag and all the state flags, MIA, Canadian flags, and whatever else, Veterans Administration, whatever. And those men, those women, are veterans, and they lead because they have led, they have fought for us, and they deserve that. Right behind them, then traditional, and then the other lesser traditional categories. Then it comes to the women. Women's traditional elder, and then women's traditional, and then so down the line to Jingle Crest comes up fast because it's actually a medicine dance. So they have a special category. The shawl dancers and just the general riffraff, that's what we call them. I'm just messing with them. So that line comes in this very distinctive order. And then as they dance in, they'll come around clockwise and then stand and dance in position until that drum stops. And then once everybody's in, they're going to do right off the bat, everybody would be standing for this and the next two songs, what we call honoring songs, which you can honor anybody. If the kid's got straight A's, we can have an honoring dance for them. Everybody would stand up. And as those kids walk by, they everybody knows who got the straight A's. You guys have A? Is that how you do it? Or is it 4.0? But then we would all stand and honor you. And we would get to see. And after, you might shake your hand and say, good job. You know, and then we would also stay standing for the next thing is the flag song, and nobody dances to the flag song. You're at attention. You're stuck wherever you're standing. That's you're stuck. So they do a flag song, and the veterans are out in a formation out front with the flags. And as soon as that stops, we're going to sing one. And actually, is a Vietnam song. However, any song. Any veteran's song, even though this one refers to Vietnam specifically, it's for all veterans. universally. So, in fact, we could, I've said, instead of Vietnam, I'd like ad-lib Afghanistan. It doesn't matter. Every veteran knows what this is, their song. And they're expected to at least stand up. And if they're in a wheelchair, then they roll them out. And they're there. They want to be there. Ladies, too. They dance around one time while the flag stands at attention. All the veterans will come in. And when that stops, the veterans will put and post all the colors. Salute, it's military. Now we're done with that. So everybody would sit down at that, no, they would remain standing, and then we would have a grand entry flag and then veterans. So we have the flag song. That's when they're standing in attention. Then the veterans would post that, the colors, then the veterans will all dance together. Sometimes they'll be the tail dancer or the arena director will go like this. That means all dance. So once they go around one time, then everybody can join in, all families. In fact, if my father wasn't there, but he's a veteran, so I'll say that. I'm going to dance with my father. You dance for years. So we'll do that for them. And we have another set of songs that this is purely Indian. Called old moccasin dance, where they would give the young people with energy the moccasins of the elders, and they would put them on and dance with them in vigorous form and put energy back into them and then give them back. So I mean, this is the Indian world. The smallest subtle things mean a great deal sometimes. In fact, it all means something. The way this Ed will talk about the way a young father, that's the drum altar area. Called an altar, if you will, but he'll explain that. So for our regalia, it tells us what kind of dances we're going to do as well. So I'm not going to be doing a double flip, you know, with the fancy bustles from Oklahoma, which those guys are doing. That's not what I'm doing. We're traditional dancers. He can do that. I've seen him do it. He used to. In fact, he has those bustles. But right now our regalia is dictating more how we're supposed to behave and you can expect how we will dance. And when category comes up for our categories, I'm not paying attention. You can get one of the ladies, and I've had it happen, just gives me the cross-eyed look, you know, and I'm getting yelled at Indian way. I'm like, okay, don't yell so loud with your eyes. But she's like, you know, this is veteran having a traditional dance. And all the women will stand there, and if their men folk are there dancing, especially the wives, mothers, sisters, and relatives, female relatives, will stand there. And they'll dance, you know, on the edge like that. And likewise for us, if our wives and our children are dancing, we're absolutely standing for them. Whether anyone else does or not, it's not my problem. And we don't care if there's 1,000 bazillion people. When Coretta Scott King came over to UNH, we were up on that stage. We don't care. I don't care if the entire audience, which it was, the entire stadium was filled. What do we care? It's not stage fright, isn't it? That's not what this is about. It's between me and God. We're in church. I'm going to say the word God. Maybe not in public school, but here, the Creator, whatever the name you use for the Creator, that's my only. That's my only critic. Well, I think of you know what he thinks of me, and you know, and what you all see, you know, is a presentation. So it's an explosion of celebration, and it's an explosion of expression, personal expression. Everything this man has on him comes from somewhere. He got it, or was given it, or made it, or bought it, or some. He's got a story that just screams head. This screams other things. But anyway. But there's no accident on these regalias. And the women will spend a whole winter making their own, but they also make the ones for the children. And sometimes the Lakotas and those guys will beat the bottoms of the moccasins. And they know the kids are going to scuff them, and those beads will just be flying off. But they did it. And it's like, maybe we mess up many moccasins here. You know, the grandma might do that. So this is so Indian. So Indian to think this. And it was here, too. We just don't know when Samuel de Champlain came, it was already over. It was already over. We have no idea what real, what subtle cultural differences between the Piscataqua group and the Penacook, which is basically the entire Merrimack River drainage, and the opening of the ocean, because they need the access from the mountains and to the ocean and the lakes just to survive for food. And all the great rivers in this region are like that. North of here, they're more nomadic. In south of here, you have agricultural people. And it's a kind of different, it's a different energy because they don't have to travel as much. Hunting camps and all that. Well, anyway, so I wanted to explain that about the regalia. I'm not going to apologize that we don't have any women with us tonight, but the modern cloth and the ribbon work and the bead work and then the silver brooches. Do you have any silver brooches?
Somewhere.
Were brought from made by European tailors, silversmiths, metalworkers, and craftsmen for the Indian trading. Some of it, George Washington never wore armbands. Here we have a great Indian adaptation of the gorget. What's called in French, it's the officer's emblem when worn on duty in the colonial period here. So it was, if for a European officer to wear that, is now Indianized. So we had a lot of them have animal totems, which is a goden, which is your family clan, bears and running elk and birds and starbursts. Has nothing to do with the King of England's royal arms on it or anything like that. This is uniquely Indianized to order. It had the Europeans do this for them. Later on, they got some skills and did it themselves. So isn't that fun stuff? And I hope that explains a little bit. And we're going to ask that you have some questions at the end. And we're more than happy to ask. So as we go along, maybe that'll be answered for you. And in the meantime, that's right.
You tap the drum four times to get something wrong.
Old Indian trick. Well, that's true. The four hits on the drum, it's like, okay. So this is a Menominee, which is our Algonquin people from the Green Bay, Wisconsin area. It's you'll hear that word Vietnam.
Hey, 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 hey
Says, "You're looking good. Where when? Thank you." Say, "Thank you." Well, when I'm we say thank you, we say the great for you around here, it's one money or what you want.
I just want to talk a little bit about the drum. This is such a central and vital part of our lives and our world. You see a big drum here, this is what we call this a powwow drum, and this is definitely not from here. The powwow drum is a Plains influence. The traditional powwow drum is this, though. So people will look at this and say, oh, it should be a beautiful log and made like this, and that's not what a powwow drum is from. The powwow drum was taken from the Fife and Drum Corps. Take that drum, sit it down, and sing on that. We'll sing on anything. So we've sung on trash can lids and anything, color hoods, it doesn't matter. But the traditional large powwow drum came to the East Coast in maybe the middle 1900s, in 1940 or 1950, at the early stages of powwows when they really started to hit this coast. Before there are gatherings, social gatherings, ceremonial gatherings was our norm. It was not these large-scale powwows that we see, you know, if you go to a powwow at Skimitz in Northern Museum or something like that. Our drums were smaller, portable drums like this, you know. So this is on an ash frame, and then, yeah, exactly. We'll get smaller as the night goes on. So this little drum here is very portable and can be used anywhere, you know. The drum, we call the drum our Mishomis. Mishomis is our grandfather. So all the teachings that we learn from our lives come from our elders. And in our elders, we learn our language, we learn our dance, our customs, our traditions, all from the drum. And like Ken said, you know, when you're at a gathering, there's one that Alex, who invited us here tonight, thank you for having us tonight, Alex, and also the Rye Public Library and the Historical Society, all these people who have worked so hard to bring us here. And we're working towards a larger event at Orion Point in 2023. And tonight is just a tiny little sampling of what that could look like. You know, we have... Ken and I have been doing this. I think we've got 100 years combined between us if you had one. Most of those are his. I say to do a backflip, but sure, you know. So, well, I won't call it up now, it's a hard floor. But so the little drum, the Mishomis, is where we learn, you know, and we teach each other songs. You know, I sat in the car, I was the first one here in the parking lot singing songs at the driver's wheel. And I think the lady came up from the house and took her kids back in the house. I don't know what your neighborhood now, Alex. And the drum, you know, there's so many other things that go into the drum. And like Ken said, you know, we have a good time and we laugh a lot, but we take what we do very seriously, less ourselves, you know. And thinking about the drum, you know, it being round is the shape of the earth. It's the shape of the moon, it's the shape of the sun, and all of those things come together that when we sing on the hand drum like this, it's taking all the energy from the whole universe and bringing it together into one. Also incorporated in here is the medicine wheel, the four directions of wind, oh my goodness, I guess we can on that one go on for, you know, a long time about all the different teachings of the drum. When we are at a larger gathering, that altar that's set up here, we'll always have one person who's here sitting with that drum. Like, we never leave them alone. You know, it's just like if we go to a lot of schools, you know, we do school programs. I think we might do some in Rye in the spring. And, you know, we talk about that sacred space and that the teachings that that drum provides us. But anyway, I would like to sing a song. I have a friend here tonight and who traveled an awful long way to come and to be with us tonight. And I know this is not part of your pre-required presentation, Kenny. But I'd like to sing this to bring everyone together. Sometimes we'll sing these after an event is over. You ever go to a powwow, you want to stay until everything's gone. As soon as everything dissipates, you know, then we come back in the circle and we have some fun. But we hope to be able to present some of these at Orion. We have many, 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 many connections for, you know, we can bring in lots of dancers and singers
Carol.
And yeah, genuine. This is all we've done. You know, I've been dancing since I was 1 year old. I danced long before I even knew I could walk, you know. And singing, you know, we've had singing groups for years and all that. So this is kind of what we love to do, and we're just happy to have an audience of people who are interested to hear a little bit. But this song is much better.
We kill it as a man, the woman brings it back to life. We with the decorations and the sewing and the tin and the brain can deer skin, the softness, making it soft, stretching it and making that. So she brings it back to life. But the man, now we just blast stuff. Before that was the other way. But anyway, the idea is that it all represents something. And as I'm saying, this is a big drum. It's straight up from the military. They used to give them out here on the eastern seaboard from the governments to Indian delegations coming into the state house. But this is, like you said, they just assume turn a little brass kettle over and use a stick on it. It's just to keep time.
Almost rather.
Yeah. And then, of course, we have these other instruments. We call them a shishiquan, or a shaker. We don't call them a rattle. We call them a shaker. And this was apparently the first sound in the universe, according to the Ojibwe traditions. So this isn't just taken for granted, either. And it has a variety of materials. We use some cow horns, you know, from an old powder horn, birch bark, elm bark, whatever we have in our region. The elm bark came from more New York State, Iroquois, which are not necessarily our best friends, sometimes. But we see that, elm bark, that's very common with them.
Elm bark.
And even the things inside them. And there are other shakers. Sometimes they use gourds. And it'll be like, now we use a bird shot in it, which is typical for a hunting community. You know, they have plenty of bird shots. But also pebbles or corn kernels. A certain number of them. If you have 13 in there for the first 13 moons of the year, the calendar year, or some other symbolic number. So with any of this stuff, I might walk up to him and just start counting things. I want to really understand this man. I might start counting, and that's important too. You know, nothing is taken for granted. And if there's certain numbers, like with the Iroquois in New York, the five nations later become the six. So you see five and six. That's so not from here. Not normal. Of course, if they gave him that, then he wears it and with pride, but he's knowingly wearing it. So we have other numerologies here. Four is almost universal for Indians and good luck, and seven, or even eight, because the four dimensions, earth and sky, and then the unknown, that makes eight. It depends on who you're talking to and what their cosmos is like. It's very important to them. Might not mean a thing to us. But if we see a Dene person, a Navajo person, a Dene, they're doing something, and I might not know, you know, anything about their culture, but I can appreciate they're doing something purposefully, and I just want to support them as they express that. What you got? Oh yeah. So speaking of the longhouse, in New York State. This is a moccasin song, moccasin dance song, old moccasin, they call it. Old moccasin dance. Yes. And this is a little water drum. This is very common on the East Coast. Almost everybody on the East Coast, even into the frozen areas, sometimes the water drums are that tall, made out of a little hollow log, different ways of this wire. Just a little bit of water in the bottom and could blow air through that wet deer skin and wet it. So it makes a completely different sound. They say this will travel across the lake where the big drum won't, the sound. So these go fast. Thank you. third degree in the Daywin, Ojibwe priest. And not this kind of priest either. It's this kind. He brought that little boy traveler water drum. They have in the lodge. They have a lodge as long as his church. They make a Brush Arbor lodge. Now they use a plastic tarp, but in the old days it would have had bark on it or mats. And everybody would contribute to that while the ceremony was going. Well, Merle came down, and we did a sweated edge house once, but I actually got married over at Agamemnon's. And he stayed right at the beach. We put him up at this little hotel right on the beach. And it was a whale that died. It got washed ashore, right across the road. I don't know what he thought of that, but that was significant. But I know every time he brought that little boy traveler to this, back to the coast, where they say the migration of the Anishinaabe people, this is all equal. Today it's the Wabanaki, but in the Great Lakes, it's the Anishinaabe people came from here. So for them to get that water drum and the pipes to be called back again for little ceremonies, it's like it's coming. It's coming back to the people who's lost these things. This is a beautiful tradition. I've seen priests at these ceremonies come in and they're like, you know what? I can't find anything wrong here. I came here thinking I was going to see the devil. But you know what? He says, all I see is friendship, family, and love. He said, this is beautiful. I still want you guys to come to Mass on Sunday. But I'm just saying, he could find nothing wrong with it. It's a beautiful way. But it brings us all together with one purpose. And that is to dance. I mean, we're dancing. Why do we dance? Why do we dance? A warrior could dance. And they have warriors dance. You see the antics we have with our clubs. I'm not like threatening anybody. That's not what this is. What I'm saying, if anybody harms you or threatens you, you call. You call us, your uncles. I'm gonna hit them with this thing. So that's what I'm showing everybody. I'm like, we're ready. We're on duty for you. You ladies and our elders and our children. We're on duty. We're at federal. You know. You go. Okay, yes, ma'am. You know, if I gotta do it, I gotta do it. But that's what we're showing. But in those days, the warrior would be expected. Not like, I am the big warrior. That's not what that is. He is expected to dance that dance. We have a seat-up dance, they call. And what you can see, even sometimes they said here in the East, it would show how they were sleeping in their camp or practicing.
Yes.
Okay. This is a pantomime dance. A lot of them are. You'll see different motions. And you try to figure out what it is that they're showing you. So this is the warrior, he's checking his bow. The hunter, he's checking his bow, he's checking his arrows, make sure they're not like crooked arrow. Broken arrow is one of the chiefs. So let me imagine, as we're thinking when we were young, old strong horse, he's an Narragansett, and broken arrow, he's a Narragansett. And they used to do these at the powwows, and they would stop the powwow and they would do this pantomime. This is an ancient thing. So I want you to use your imagination. And see, on the fourth try, they try to lift the deer up. So I'm gonna push around some water. Oh my God, you know, I'm thirsty, you know. So I'm gonna push some debris off the water and drink. When I'm looking, you know, you see them scouting, you see them looking for signs, tracks, and things like that. And hopefully you'll see this. But it's a fun dance. But it's meaningful, and a lot of them do this for different reasons. And the warriors no less. You see them paddling canoes, fighting, and in a sneak up dance, they're actually searching through the grass with their fallen brother. And they're fighting their way over, they're ducking arrows and gunshots, and you see them doing all this stuff. So it's a real heavy dance, and they're expected to show, maybe even that in advantage, strike a war pose. Then he goes and sits down, you know. Stuff like that.
Wait. I did a presentation similar to this on Saturday night at Green Acre, the Elliott, in Elliott, at the Baha'i Center. And after I danced, you know, there was a bunch of questions, and somebody asked me, what do you think about, did you ask me that? What do you think about when you dance? And I couldn't really think of anything. I didn't really know how to answer that question. I don't know, it's, when I dance, I like to just not have to think about all these other things. You know, that's my happy place, is to dance. But then, you know, it was a great question, though, because it really did make me think, and all of these roots of all of these different specialty dances that we grew up with as kids, the canoe dance, and just that motion of, you know, pulling oneself forward like that. Like, all of those things come in. I don't know, I guess I've just been doing it for such a long time, I didn't necessarily think about it until I was asked, so I really appreciated that question. But this, we, as little kids, we used to watch, you know, we would go to powwows, and then powwows were more Eastern-oriented, they were stories. And the dances told stories. And this is one of the dances that was really a favorite, because it was very slow, and you could really watch and see. And sometimes there was a narrator, so sometimes there was a drunk, and a narrator, and the dancer at the same time. But I think I'll let your story tell itself, because Ken is an expert at the hunting dance. Thank you. family.
It's funny, so it's a cultural thing. If we brought the beer in as a man, my other auntie could say, okay, we'll just put it over here. But he's like, but I am a woman, I am in need. I have children, I have my grandchildren, my nieces. Yes, ma'am, I'll go get another one. Yes, ma'am. So what I do, but if I bring it in, no. So what I do is I leave it out in the bush. I put it up on a sun gauge when a platform or somehow. And then I come in, right? I'm cold and wet and hot. I sit by the fire, taking my moccasins off. So by and by, she says, my wife says, so, did you get a deer? And I would say, as a matter of fact, I did. If you go out 3 clicks and turn right at the bear that looks like a rock and turn left at the rock that looks like a bear, you'll see my broken twigs. See the broken twigs? I was breaking twigs, where I was checking broken twigs for the deer pack. Anyway, I do that a lot. And so off she goes with the girls. Might take the toboggan, you know, on the snow, for example, and they'll butcher it, and they'll bring it in. Then I might be gone overnight. You know, so let me come back in. If any of our aunties would say, or her girlfriends, you know, hey, I have to use my Eastern Woodland Indian accent, ladies' accent. She'd say, sister, Kelly Clark, sister, hey, can I have some of that Dion Weyas? Oh, sure, sister, sure, you can have some. She can't demand it of another woman. But I outsmarted them all by leaving them out there. That's up to the women to fight over. They're very happy to share because we're all in the same canoe, like sometimes literally. But we're sharing resources, and next week it might be us. So, I thought that it's a really couple of layers of Native culture and humor embedded in that. There's all kinds of examples of that. So if they come up to you and say, oh, sister, I love those earrings. Okay, here you go. I mean, so it's almost like when they say, may double land, how are you? In Micmac, you say, may double land, you say, oh, my back's hurting, my leg's hurting. Don't ask them how they are. Gee, you're looking good. No, I'm sitting up. You're looking good. Then they go, oh, yeah, I guess I am. So there's some definite Indian doings that are very deeply embedded culture. And I've literally got Larry, the Ojibwe guy, remember?
Yeah.
I had this great Ojibwe shirt I got from Perry Sound from Uncle Merle's reserve up at Wasatch. And it's an Ojibwe Nike. You've never seen a shirt like this. They wore them at the Toronto Olympics, right? Indian Olympics. Ojibwe Nike. Victory. Well, he saw that as he was coming into the powwow. I was working the gate. It was pouring rain, and I'm like, hey, it's nice to see you guys. He goes, where did you get that shirt?
Now I'm sure.
Oh, now I'm sure. Here you go. And off they went to the camp over there. And I'm like, now I gotta go get my. But you know what? That was perfect Indian manners. Perfect Indian manners. And he wouldn't say a dang thing. Like, oh, now you're gonna be cold. No, shut up. I just gave you my thing. Just I know the rules. Let's just accept the gift. Accept the gift. It's okay. It is okay. And be good, be honorable when you sang that song for me. I wanted to dance to that. I could have stood there and been a bump on the line. But I wanted to dance. And we're gonna see that at the powwow. We're gonna see social dancing. There's couples dancing. Plenty of opportunity, usually ladies' jokes, as a matter of fact. And big round dances, they can go on for hours, all night long, those Pueblos. That's all they do. I think they have one shorter leg than the other. But they reverse directions. But all that would be explained, and I would suggest that you would be welcome to come in when it's appropriate. They'll tell you, they'll say. So ladies, if you brought a little shawl with you, you are completely, and shod a foot, you are completely appropriate enough to come into that circle. So if you just some teenage chick, you know, I'm just saying that, but if they're just out there doing anything, that's okay. It's okay. But if the ladies have a little, just a little shawl, even a symbolic one, an afghan from the back seat of the you know, on the back of the car, that shows that you know something. You know, because that mash coat, they call that majigat, is it's the same word for a skirt or this light blanket. And they were beautifully ribbed if you're deliberately making them. But any little cloth will do. And you just fold it nicely. You just have to have it on you. You can wear it. And sometimes it gets heavy. You know, things get heavy, you know, with like, you know, you put it over your head like a hood, like only a woman can, you know, when it's like some serious stuff. They put it on like a hood and it's off they go. But otherwise, it's great formally, and they have the fan, and they're not. They're just dancing. And they can talk to the neighbor. They well, Tiffany, how are you doing? Oh, Betsy, I'm doing fine. This is the same present. When you're dancing, you run into these traffic jams in the circle. And then you have to, like, okay, I'm not getting around those four women. I'm not even going to disrupt that. I don't know what's going on here. So we'll artfully dance around. But you see all this going on. But hopefully, you can be participants as well. This is not just for, and now you're thoroughly qualified to do so. Because that guy, those guys in the winter program told us so. But that is a fact. When they say veterans, it means all of you guys that were wearing military boots at one time. You're more than, in fact, we almost expect you. You don't have to dance. Just walk. It's okay. You got to limp. The DOD, I don't know. But no one's going to say anything, nor would they. They just want your presence. So you can inspire the young people to see that. That's who those guys are. We're very tongue-in-cheek, but don't you want it that way?
Yes.
Socioeconomic tradition of the social structure, you don't want that. This is very human.
3 years ago, I took my family to New Mexico, our extended family. Some of my family members have been there. I've been many, many, many times. I go out every year, and I've gone for about 34 years, at least once a year, maybe twice. And we have family on Amos Pueblo, and we went to visit them for this certain event. We went out for a ceremony. It was on November 12th, and it was the feast at Amos Pueblo, and they have a big dance, and how do the Pueblo people celebrate? They give away food, right? So every home on the whole Pueblo was open. You could walk in any house and eat, sit down at their kitchen table, and they would serve. And so many of my family members had never even been to New Mexico, so we went with 18 of us. And we went to our relative's home, Esther Sandler. We were at their home, and then we walked down to the old plaza, and we went to that dance and the celebration. And coming out of the kiva, we counted 1,500 people come out of one kiva, all dressed, out into the plaza. And that was one of their kivas. They have two. There were 3,000 dancers in this plaza, which is like a long kind of a dirt, little bit of a concave, is that right? Center of their village. And they had their dance. It was all choreographed, one drum. All these people, there were thousands of people all over, crammed into tiny little alleyways. One drum and behind 125 singers. And you could hear them come from the four corner directions, and they would drum and sing, and all of the dancers did this choreographed harvest dance. It mimicked the rows of corn and the rows of people that came into that dance. And of course, we were with family who was from there and that spoke the language, so they were able to interpret for us. But at a dance like that, you cannot bring your phone, you can't even bring a pencil and paper. feel, take all of those from you. You just have to go and take that home in your heart, right? That's that, how that is. You know, we're such a culture that we want to have everything so we can hold on to it forever. And sometimes it's just a moment. That moment is important. And if you can take that time and realize that that sacred moment is what it is, that all of those moments can be that. And one of the excursions that we did on that trip, we went to Bandelier National Park. Anyone ever been there? Bandelier, yeah. So you go to Bandelier National Park, and it's like every other national park, and you go in and you play and you shop and you whatever. And then my mother and Esther stayed, and they sat there because they were elderly and they couldn't walk in further. And so the rest of us walked into Bandelier. But as you walk down, it's the ancient Anasazi ruin. It's been uninhabited for hundreds of years. They have all the dates and all that. But it's an old abandoned. On the right side is a stone wall. There's a stone wall goes up, I don't know, 5 stories, 6 stories, 7 stories, it's high. And it's a big flat wall, and you walk out, and this wall is on the right. And as you walk out toward the ruin, there are kivas in the ground. And the kiva is their ceremonial, it's their church. And the kiva is laid out so that half of it is underground, and the other half is above ground. And it's, you've probably seen pictures of these. It's a round building, and it's got the ladder going up one side. There's no door. So they climb up the ladder and down inside. And the top half of that from the ground up represents the earth and the sky. And then it's the equal size from the ground level down, and that represents the earth. And so the building is balanced inside. Nobody knows what happens inside. He would never tell me a single thing. So as we walked out, because it's ruined and that the top, you know, which would have built from wood and stucco and mud and all that was gone, so it was a hole in the ground. And there was a little bit of the structure still left inside of concrete or stone seats on all four directions and a stone, like a step almost around the perimeter on the inside. And so we were a large group, and we were with Carl. He looks like he's right off of the Edward Curtis cover of magazine, you know. And there was another group who was also looking into the same hole. And they had a guide. And the girl had a brown suit on, State Park, and the hat and everything. And she was there, and she did a wonderful job, you know. In 1627, like Ken was saying, in 1627, the abandonment. And she had all the dates and all the information. It was really interesting. And she had a group of maybe 6 or 7 people. And then, so we were kind of listening, but we were just very quiet outside. And so as we all looked inside, and I was standing right next to Carl, it's from there, his people are direct relation of the Anasazi people, the Hemus Pueblo. They speak Towa language, which is a direct relation from Anasazi. And so he looked, he was just talking. And here's one where we had all of the information, and here's this one where we had direct knowledge. And that direct knowledge was just like, he was just talking about the stars and the sky and when they come down inside into the earth and bring the people. He was just talking to himself, I think. And wouldn't you know, pretty soon, fancy word of the dates or the times. Anybody can do that. But he had that experience. And I think one of the interesting things that I'm so interested in having communicated with Alex about being here and why is that I think we have an opportunity to share genuine culture with the town. And we've been approached to start tonight and maybe as a primer or as an opening to explain a little bit about who we are, but then to be able to build on this, and I think we're going to go into the schools in the springtime and work with the students, we do crafts with them or dances, you know, if COVID is done by then or wherever we're at by that time, it can be more interactive. But then also to work with the town of Rye, and that in 2023 at the 400th anniversary at Odeorn, we have been asked to bring this and add water to it and bring a presence to the park for that weekend, for a weekend in June. I don't know if there's one chosen already. Did we choose a weekend?
Yeah, 10th, 11th.
Yes! So on that weekend, the proposal is to bring, you know, Ken and I have been involved in organizing Indian powwows in New England for, you know, a long time. And my father before me was a master of ceremonies at powwows all over New England. Our family has organized lots and lots of powwows. We have connections to drum groups like the real, you know, if you go to a concert, no, there's Bob and Mary from down the street with a violin, or here in support, or you could have like the Rolling Stones, you know. We can bring the Rolling Stones. You know, and the thing is, with those kinds of drum groups like this, but 10 men and 10 women, and with that kind of drum group, that brings the essence. And then you've got quality dance. And with the dancers, then you have genuine music and dance, and then the vendors will say, I want to be at that because they're going to be a great draw. And that's how it builds, is by bringing great music, bringing great dance, and then bringing genuine culture and art and exhibitions into the town.
And food.
Yeah. So I know that's something that we'll be quite interested to work with Alex and with the town, and we're very happy and honored to have been asked to be here tonight and to be able to share a little bit of this and to be able to use this as a stepping stone kind of going forward. And then we'd be happy to come back in any different capacity, if it was a little more one-on-one or, you know, teachings or different things like that. So I guess I just wanted to say thank you so much for having us here. It really is an honor. And with COVID and all, I think one of the last presentations I did was with Ken. It was in March of 2020. We were at Bristol Consolidated School in Bristol, Maine. We were artists in residence for a week. We had, on Monday, we do a presentation for the whole elementary school, and then we broke all these students by grade up, by nation, and each grade was a different representing a different nation from the area, and they made regalia, they learned dances, they learned songs, they had food, the whole school was at the disposal. So that by Friday night, we would do a presentation with all of the students in front of all of the town and community, and it was that Friday, my wife called me every night, hey, you gotta watch the news, and it was that week that COVID was coming on, and we realized by that weekend, we're on the same weekend when the world shut down. And, so I think it's appropriate that I get to be
that happy. Night was supposed to be the grand finale Friday night. There would normally be 500 family members or more in the gymnasium.
Yeah.
And all those kids have trade silver. We made it out of tinfoil over cardboard, but the black markings made it look like it was beautiful trade silver. It was shiny. They made everything.
Headdresses.
Brian, they had everything, and they learned. We drilled those kids all week long, and those eighth grade girls. Those were babies. They picked up this these Longhouse songs. We did that for them. Anyway, that got canceled that night. The whole state shut down as of that night. So just before they got on their buses, the last thing they knew before COVID was our dress rehearsal. And they were dressed,
and we did.
And it was about 50 parents kind of got the message through the somehow, miraculously, they showed up. And it was amazing. Yet again, we've done it three times up there or so. But it was the last thing. They didn't remember algebra or anything like that. It was good stuff. And it was a real pleasure to go out for that.
Yeah.
And it was really emotional, too. But this can all be done. It can be brought here. We do this at school. This is a very typical school program. We We bump it up a little bit for a more mature audience, but with, depending on what grade of school, we take that into consideration. On, you know, what information we can, you know, which is happy stuff or, but we, you know, we don't mince words. You know, we tell them like words. This is real.
Did anyone here go to the Apollo and Elliot in 2015? I know you did.
I know you did.
Yeah.
I know you did.
That was a memorial Apollo that was put on for my father.
That was great.
So good.
Yeah. Thank you.
Well, our family, I'm from.
He hasn't been the same since.
That's right. I think we corrupted him. But yeah, that was a large event, and we wouldn't be able to do something like that here. But you know, between this and that, you know, is kind of what we're imagining to happen out at Woody North. You know, camps and exhibitions, and kind of depends on the town, you know. And
some are a dance, so the natives go, and it's just straight up Indian business. It's like category after category, and then other ones. You stop and explain and answer questions.
Yeah.
Yes. Are the arm those animals?
An arm band?
Yeah, an arm band. Is that decorative or does that other function?
You want to talk about silver?
It's sterling silver. He's probably wearing more sterling silver on his body than most settlers own in their house. And he lives in the bushes at a park wigwam. But yet they were highly, all these products were not the junk. They don't want to sell, they don't have any use for junk. They're living out of a canoe. So you do not have time to buy a brass kettle that's this big. You know, when you need one like this, that's this big. If you have a longhouse in New York, sure, it's a cauldron and it stays there. But we're on the go. So these objects are not only valuable, so they demanded quality in all cases. Cloth and sterling silver. A couple guys got in trouble for dipping tin in mercury or something, and the white washes off very quickly, or they just make it thinner. But the significance is sometimes they would have local silversmiths know the local culture enough to make certain designs, like lightning designs. But notice the placement of these. It's if you think of the body, think of what a dream catcher does. A dream catcher is hanging it on their rearview mirror and everywhere else, but your kitchen window. But really what it's for is for a cradle board. Because they say that we need all the dreams, and good and bad, it's just dreams. But some are pretty heavy. But a child, a baby, can't handle that. We can handle. We need those hard lessons in our dreams. But a child, a small baby, can't do that. So they put these on there to confound outside influences that are not so great. And it's like a spider web in the morning dew, and it catches everything. So if you think about that concept, at certain times we unbraid our hair. We take all ornaments off, have no makeup on. Only pipestone powder is allowed, for example. So ornaments and just the way the clothing is worn, if stuff is coming up off the ground, imagine the it's like a highway to the center of our soul, our heart, and a lot of things are depicted with their heart in an X-ray heart. So a lot of these highways, if he holds his arm out, you know, if he touches the wrong thing and eats the wrong thing they shot some Cree guys, and then the Indians that were with them said, "We can't touch that food." But what they did is they painted their mouth so that food was protected. It was a barrier. So as it goes down the line, it's a protection. If you think of it, the tattoo marks did this exact same, like a barbed wire fence, only just a series of them, and better that it's reflective back at you like a mirror. So shining is good.
Yeah.
So I'm shiny is good. Yeah, that's not a, he does green himself a lot. That's not. They used to have carvings of elk magic. That's for girlfriends. And the Lakota would like flash the and it could be just a shiny board. It didn't even, you know, like polished wood, but it had the elk symbols, and he would flash that at the girls, like, you know, and magic. There's a lot of magic that goes on today we're not supposed to do that because that's wrong. So we have that, we've been told that that's wrong, to manipulate other human beings with magic. That's called conjuring and witchcraft and so on. However, what we're doing is just calling in good luck. It just, if there's nothing wrong with that. We can, for good luck for traveling, go out on a boat, go in a car, we have an endeavor, we're going for a job interview, we're going for that big date, and you want that girl, you might, oh gosh, I don't know, I think Nikki conjured me, I'm pretty sure about that. But these are all, like I said, there's no joke about this stuff, and you'd have to ask him, or maybe he wouldn't even tell you. He might just change the subject and not want to get into it. In fact, there might be a lot of reasons that he wouldn't say. But you could see certain things. But those ornaments are placed, but George Washington doesn't have armbands. This is so uniquely Indian. But it's also a common and a logical place. But if for a warrior or a hunter, that joint is also a target for conjuring of your enemy. So shoulders and these brooches all over the shoulders with red paint. What was all that about? Top of the head, no Indian is Indian. No native dancer is complete without head ornamentation. You see these guys out there with great outfits and then nothing on the head. It's completely the other way around. Those guys could be completely have nothing but a piece of grass around their belt. But their head is ornamented. The top of the head, where the scalp lock braid goes, that's the top soft spot on the baby. We all know that's where the soul comes in and out, and so to take that hair, the chevelure, as the French call it, right? Now I got their soul. So that's what that is. You know, it's a not a live prisoner, that's what that is. But all these ornaments are placed in the red hair for good luck and fire, but it's a deer, it's a bucktail. Not a doe, that's a bucktail. Then porcupine guard hair, I'm not even touching it, see, I can point, yeah, thank you. And then whatever feathers or whatever other ornaments are important to that man or that person or that culture, it means something, it screams something, some messages in his world. George Washington walks up and goes, oh, and they wore pumps of deer skin and some other trinkets. They're like, okay, this with lightning bolts and thunder beams, there's nothing on earth that can stand up to a tornado, yes, and a lightning bolt. No king, no general, no nobody. We are all, so we incorporate that and we honor it. We don't want to call it in, but we acknowledge it. And then we kind of borrow from that energy. So like arrows have lightning bolts engraved and then smeared with red paint. All those Sioux arrows out that shot Custer, you look at them in the museums, they got lightning bolts right down that middle of that arrow. What do you think that is? That's exactly what that is. You know? So nothing here is an accident. And it is an amazing, it's an entire PhD thesis that you could just study these objects in museums and actually try to figure them out. And there's no evidence a lot of times that, you know, this is our feelings on them. But another anthropologist, well, there's no evidence for that. I mean, we encounter that all the time. You're like, listen, dude, I'm telling you, I made this, I put this, I shot the thing, I put it on, I know what it is, I know where it came from. To me, I don't care what you think or what you say or what book you read or books or PhD, I know what this is and I know where I got it. So I don't know what to tell you. If you were humble enough, you would hear this and you would learn. But I couldn't look it up on YouTube, is it? I'm not going to look it up on Google. It's not there. This stuff is not on there. These books are great that Alex brought in from the library and from his library. There's stuff in there, but it's not even scratching the surface. The real Indian culture is why you're here. And that's why you just want a piece of this. Because there's so much parts that no matter who your family is and your heritage and your religions, you can get so much power or strength from the heart. To know what half of this stuff is. You're like, because you all do the same thing. You do it right now. You have your favorite shirt. Everybody have your favorite shirt. Why is that? What's that mean? You know, you have little rituals that you do. We're in the modern world and we're living here, but I'm telling you, it's in us. It's from ancient Greece, ancient Ireland, ancient Germany, ancient Japan, Japan. It's like a bunch of Indians that invented steel and stonework. The Shinto is so Indian. It's just that, I mean, I'm just trying to encourage everybody to really, really gobble this stuff up, because everything, we're just like throwing stuff out at you, because like, isn't this cool? Isn't this cool? To us, it is. And we hope you do. We hope you really enjoy it. But that now, the next time you see it on a movie, you're critical. And you know, Dances with Wolves, there's a good one. There's a lot of stuff in that. They had some good advisors in that. It's still Hollywood. We know that. But very clean Indians. But other than that, yes, absolutely. Sorry. Sure, is there another question? You guys have any questions? What? So our little girl? Oh, yes, ma'am. See, now there's, actually, some of my objects are in that museum. You notice the big canoe in the lobby? Where do you think they got their wampum cuffs? We actually were doing a thing, Dustin and Dave and I were out in Michigan doing school programs, and we got the call, so we were like taking our sweat-stained wampum cuffs and things, and then drop shipping them to the movie. They use them in Tennessee for the movie at their orientation, and then they put them smack in the exhibit. But they did it. They chose to have those objects because they are not, it's a self-expression of Indian, what they want to express in their history. And that's a really unique thing. So these new Indian museums that are being built, the Chickasaws are a lot of fun, funding a big one out in Oklahoma. And it's like, it's all the nations, I think it's just of Oklahoma, I'm not sure, but the Chickasaws are involved. And for them to express, and they got a movie coming up, we're working with them with a movie, what they want to see in their own movie, that will be fascinating. I've heard a few things in those meetings that I've been to with them, but I want to see this thing on the screen. Now, the last time I used it was nothing, even though they had Native advisors and they had Native actors, but this is the other way around. This is homegrown Indian art, I guess. But as those museums, it's a great thing that now they have some funding and they're able to do those. Most of them have a little historical society. And those are getting grants now, that which is really a good thing, because it wasn't like that in the 60s. Nobody cared. But now they're getting grant money and they're expanding and they have a storage where they work with other museums and they can store these rarer objects in a vault under climate conditions, and then they can trot them out or go view them when they need to. So all this is happening these days, as Alex was saying. This is this new era of being able to do all that stuff. But now they got the backing and the smarts. They got PhD people. They've got grant programs. They go down to Smithsonian. Those kids will just be in there for like a couple of months straight, do internships in the Smithsonian, you know, checking out all the moccasins, checking out all the archaeology stuff, and some of it was grave burials. And they got people that go in there and take care of that stuff. But that's not happening anymore. That's not happening. They're not doing that. Yeah, a bulldozer is going to hit something, and you're like, uh-oh, this way up on, Congress Avenue, what do you guys got? Two roads over, Constitution Avenue. Okay, so they hit a burial. What do? You make a couple of phone calls really quick, stop the bulldozer, and then you get right, somebody goes in there, knows what they're doing, they get it out of there, or they pave it over. is there forever. It depends on how they look at it. Because I know they've done that too. They just paved over it. They look at it, examine it, they go, yeah, they're not mohawks, they're up. They gotta know that stuff. That's important. But sometimes it's not. Sometimes the only person in town is a Navajo. And he's like, I don't want to see any of our people disrespected that way. They're not gonna be on display, none of that stuff. And this is such a breath of fresh air. So they go along with mannequins. And that's a nice, they got the information to back it up. So what you're seeing is like a still life of Ed and I just standing there. And there's actually some people in there that are mannequins. We didn't know Nani's in there.
Yeah, yeah.
Yes, ma'am. As a matter of fact, I am going to give a talk over at the Kearsage Indian Museum on Saturday on glass wampum specifically. But wampum originally was made from the quahog shell, the purple part, and the white was made. So it only comes from the coast, really. The epicenter is from Long Island Sound, Cape Cod, Narragansett Bay, and Massachusetts Bay. But these were made into small beads after the advent of a steel awl bit that was converted. You can't drill a tube out of a quahog shell. No way. And if you did, you would make one, but not a 2,000 bead belt. And an entire culture made out of these things. You can't. So once the Europeans arrived, the natives took this and this and this and made it their own. And this becomes a culture. No negotiation can be made or legitimate without wampum, without smoking a pipe, and all these. And Sir William Johnson, the Indian director of the superintendent of Indian Affairs for the King of England here in North America, he said no one of these customs could be omitted from any of these. You go to Boston, guess what you're doing? You're not doing lawyer stuff, you're doing Indian stuff. They're gonna bring it right to the governor's council chamber, and they're playing by Indian rules. Yeah, they can do their thing, but if Ed says, I'm gonna take this out of his hand in anger, but if it was a club, he literally has to remove it from my hand or out of my head. I would actually walk out my head, like he stuck a tomahawk in my head, and he would remove it because he is the one that put it there. He could too, I know he would. But that's the kind of subtleties that is not subtle. It was a very, it's like that pantomime dance. Everything had a meaning. If you use a long hand, like showing your foot to somebody in certain parts of the world, that's a tremendous insult. So nor would you do that here. We're not going to do that at our powwow. We're going to have a good time. We're going to come in through the entrance. We're going to go around in a sunwise manner. We're going to go back out the same door. We don't cut underneath the rope. That's just got no manners. We have manners. You know, you don't need a talking stick. I just will wait for you to sit down and say, all my relations, the Takuwe Oyasin, or the Kanagana. That's how they say it. So now it's the other guy's turn to stand. And he sits down, and he's like, gets back up, and I forgot something. He's like, he sits down, oh, no, I forgot something. But he didn't say all my relations yet. So he wasn't done. In the dummy world, the people with no manners, you need to give them a stick, a talking stick. It's nice, it's a nice gesture, but it just is a reminder to modern people. But an eagle feather is a different, that's a whole different ballgame, because it has actual power. And they say a pipe or the feather, your words just come out of your mouth, no lie. You can't lie with that in your hand, you can't do it. So that's a whole different thing. But yes, it's a symbol of I'm speaking at this time. And then you pass it, but that's we're going to see all of this kind of stuff at our powwow. And we're going to call it a powwow. It's a healing word in the Algonquin language. It means a healer or a healing occasion. Oh, yes, I'm sure. Thank you.
Thank you so much.
We have books tonight, not on this topic, unfortunately, but we have some books on the seacoast if you're interested in taking one home. We'd love to have you come as a gift this evening from us, and look forward to seeing you soon. So with that, we say thank you one more time.
And also, there's some artifacts, native artifacts, that were found in Rye, and they are over there on display. So please take a look.